Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Taking Down Backpage, Fighting the World's Largest Sex Trafficker, by Maggy Krell. Narrated by Sara Sheckells. The function of freedom is to free someone else. Toni Morrison. Author's note. This book is seen through my lens as a former prosecutor. The case information herein is public record. I have added to it my personal experiences and opinions. My focus is on female survivors of sex trafficking, based on the specific investigations I discuss. But there are also male, transgender, and gender nonconforming victims of sex trafficking being exploited in the United States every day. Additionally, this book focuses solely on sex trafficking, but equally egregious human trafficking is also occurring in many other industries, from restaurants and nail salons to garment factories and farms. Like sex trafficking, what's commonly referred to as labor trafficking is an extreme form of exploitation, in which a victim is forced to work with little or no pay and is not free to leave. It is not the nature of the labor, whether it is sex acts or farm work or washing dishes, but the exploitation, the working conditions, the fear, and the lack of freedom that define human trafficking, which is widely referred to as modern-day slavery. As evinced during our investigations, many of the survivors of child sex trafficking come from unstable home environments or have suffered from sexual abuse as a child. Such circumstances have impacted their self-esteem and made them more vulnerable to predators. Because of underreporting, it is difficult to accurately define the scope of child sex trafficking in the United States. In 2019 alone, the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children received reports on more than 10,700 children. I also want to recognize the growing movement of those who believe commercial sex should be decriminalized or even legalized. Indeed, it's important to acknowledge that not all commercial sex work advertised on the internet or anywhere else involves trafficking and exploitation. Sex trafficking should not be conflated with voluntary sex work. This book is not about consensual sex work. It is about rape. Those who want to see prostitution decriminalized or legalized have criticized the shutdown and prosecution of Backpage, claiming that this has made commercial sex more dangerous. The statistics don't bear this out. As a prosecutor, I saw firsthand the numerous rapes, robberies, and murders that occurred through Backpage. There was no screening, no criminal records check, no security provided. It was merely a criminal marketplace where people were sold. There was no way of knowing who would be at the other end of a call or text. Backpage made sex trafficking easy and lucrative. The survivors who were part of the Backpage case were forced into sex trafficking, most of them as children. Their names have been changed in this book to protect their privacy. They were sold in multiple cities and sometimes multiple states. They suffered long-term consequences and scars that will never heal. Those who escaped sex trafficking continue to suffer physically and mentally, struggling to overcome fear, anxiety, and sometimes drug addiction. And some victims of sex trafficking do not survive. To be clear, Backpage never made any aspect of their lives safer. Backpage increased their suffering exponentially, made it harder to escape, and made more money for their traffickers. After the shutdown of Backpage, instances of sex trafficking decreased. While other websites have emerged or expanded, there is no longer a centralized site where the sale of children is normalized. Those who choose to engage in commercial sex work are just as deserving of law enforcement protection as the countless victims who are trapped in it. Research shows there are numerous health risks associated with engaging in commercial sex, which correlates with violence and homicide rates higher than those for the general public. Sex workers should not be stigmatized, ignored, or deterred from seeking justice. But that is a different book. The focus of this book is sex trafficking victims and at-risk children who have been sexually abused, and what we did to stop it. 1. The Motel. I took my seat in court with a stack of color-coded files. Each one contained a police report, a rap sheet, and a complaint charging the defendant with violating some specific section of the California Penal Code. Green files were DUIs. Purple were regular misdemeanors like bar fights or shoplifting or the occasional illegal cockfight. Red were domestic violence. I was sorting through them, attempting to match the order of my stack with the order on the court's December 7, 2004 calendar sheet, so that I would be ready when the judge came out and began calling the arraignment names. If he called a name and I was not ready with the file, he would become impatient and make a dramatic scene about having to wait for me. The court's calendar was loosely alphabetical, except that there were add-ons. Add-ons were extra names that had been added to the end of the calendar. Half the calendar turned out to be the extra names. So there I was, furiously sorting so that I would not be fumbling through folders when the judge came out of his chambers and took the bench. I was the prosecutor. My job was to seek justice on behalf of the people of the state of California, county of San Joaquin, and also to organize the color-coded files. Each of my files contained a story about a person who made a choice, or a series of choices, that resulted in harm to another person and a law being violated. My job was to ensure that the individual responsible for the crime was held accountable, to insist on fairness, and to empower the victim. Every morning, typically wearing a crisp ironed white button-down shirt, a black skirt and jacket set, pearls and heels, I kissed my boyfriend, Carrie Huxell, goodbye, and traveled about 50 miles through thick Central Valley fog from Sacramento to Stockton, San Joaquin County's seat. I was only 25 years old, but I was tasked with decisions that would impact people for the rest of their lives, and I was trying to look at least 30 while doing it. Just as I finished arranging the files, the judge took the bench. As the metal door on the side of the courtroom was closing, I saw a cluster of defendants in orange jumpsuits hovering by the door and peering into the courtroom. The bailiff now had to call them into the courtroom one at a time, in calendar order. After the bailiff and the court clerk consulted, the judge announced that he would be calling the in-custody female defendants first. This, of course, threw my ordering system completely out of whack as I shuffled through the enormous stack trying to filter out the female defendants. It wasn't as if I could just grab Mary and Janice and Susie. The files were labeled with last names only, like Clark and Smith and Barkley. So I had to actually open them to determine the gender of the defendant inside. As I frantically reordered, the public defender and other defense attorneys started showing up. The public defender was there to represent anyone who did not have a lawyer, could not afford a lawyer, and wanted a lawyer, which tended to be almost everyone. There were a couple of private attorneys with private clients there to obtain discovery, a copy of everything in my file, get their clients out of custody, and make sure the next court date coincided with their schedule. The private attorneys would approach me, and I would pull their client's file. In many cases, we would agree to release from custody pending the next court date. Sometimes, based on the crime charged or the defendant's criminal history, I would argue that the defendant should stay in custody. The defense attorney would argue that his or her client posed no risk if released, and the judge would decide whether to reduce bail, release the defendant, or impose any other conditions. The private attorneys usually had other courtrooms they needed to be in for other clients at the exact same time, so they would ask the clerk if their cases could be called first. This meant more shuffling of the file stack. But by 9:45 a.m., the court finally started calling the 8:30 a.m. in custody calendar. San Joaquin County Superior Court was in session. The judge would read the name, ask the defendant whether it was true and correct, and proceed to read the charge: driving under the influence of alcohol or drugs, stealing from Walmart, battery, vandalism, prostitution. He would then ask the prosecution for an offer, a plea deal in which a defendant could accept responsibility for a charge at an early date in the proceedings and receive a lighter sentence than the maximum. This meant the defendant would be giving up a series of constitutional rights: to remain silent, to be presumed innocent, to receive a jury trial, and to subpoena and question witnesses against him or her. But it also meant that the defendant could receive a favorable sentence and move on with his or her life without being dragged through the criminal justice system and risking a more serious and consequential outcome. Some defendants did not get offers, either because the crimes were too serious or because the crimes required further investigation and were not suitable for early resolution. And so, the judge made his way through the female in custody calendar, reading charges, advising defendants of rights, continuing cases for further proceedings, and taking pleas. There were more female defendants than normal, because there had been a sting operation over the weekend, ensnaring many young women who were selling their bodies for commercial sex. All the files read the same. All the defendants were women, and they were all young, many of them teenagers. Almost all were African American. They were all being arrested late at night. The police reports and booking information listed their clothing, their address, and their property. The clothing was universally skimpy, consisting of short skirts, tank tops, and heels, even though it was December. The police report also listed the weather, which was in the high 30s. The property was typically a purse with a little bit of makeup inside, a toothbrush, $40 or less, and occasionally a few condoms. The home address was almost always transient, the address that gets listed on the intake sheet if someone did not have or would not give the police an address and had no ID. The defendants were either homeless or wouldn't say where they were staying. Most of them didn't have an emergency contact to list when being booked into jail. In court, they just wanted to get out of custody. They would say their names and answer the court's questions almost robotically. They would plead guilty if it meant getting out of jail. They stared blankly into space and looked numb and lifeless. They didn't seem to care whether the court appointed an attorney, whether the court pronounced their names right, or whether they gave up their constitutional rights. The police reports described scripted encounters in which an officer working in an undercover capacity approached one of these young women and asked her to perform some degrading sex act for a small amount of money that he negotiated. She would agree and initiate physical contact, and then he'd give a signal to officers waiting nearby and she'd be arrested. It was freezing cold in a dangerous stretch of downtown. Anything could happen to these young women who were offering commercial sex acts to whatever perverted stranger drove up on them, and they never seemed to even have money to show for it. Some people say prostitution is a victimless crime, but there, in the San Joaquin County courtroom, I saw the defendants for the victims they truly were, thrust into scary Stockton parking lots on a nightly basis, nowhere else to go, no one to even call, with no money and no address. Were they merely having sex for money to survive? What led these young women to this brutal place? Where were their families? Who was making money off their misery? And was anyone standing up for them? For the first time as a prosecutor, I did not want to prosecute. I was supposed to be prosecuting people who made choices to harm other people or chose to violate the law. What choices were these young women making? Was there a choice? In the women before me, in the stories, in the files on my desk, I did not see that they had any choice. I got through the morning calendar without getting yelled at by the judge, and I wheeled my stack of DUIs, thefts, and vandalism cases back to my office. But I couldn't get my mind off the prostitution defendants. I sat at my shabby plastic desk, eating a peanut butter and jelly sandwich and reading through the police reports again. I was picking a jury for an elder abuse trial at 2 p.m., but I was fully engrossed in this stack of purple files until then. I noticed one other matching detail. All the defendants were being arrested in the parking lot of the same seedy motel on a corner near downtown. I did some more research. It turned out that the motel received dozens of disturbance calls from neighbors and had been the site for many sting operations. The motel owner had to know what he was profiting from inside those rooms. Why was this business able to profit from sexual exploitation? What if, I wondered, we could target that motel? It was ground zero for this ongoing crime, a crime that I saw as a manifestation of human suffering. For a small amount of money, grown men were buying homeless teenagers in the motel parking lot. Instead of providing refuge to the teenagers and calling the police, I suspected that the motel owner was probably taking a cut on every single transaction. The teenagers never reported being victims, but that did not mean they weren't, nor would it necessarily prevent me from making a case. Before our system of constitutional democracy, people fended for themselves. It was not the job of the public or the government to get involved when a bandit stole a man's mule, much less when a man hit a woman in the comfort of his own home. These were private matters between private parties, and the party with more power would usually win. There was no public mechanism for protecting the vulnerable. The relatively modern concept of a public prosecutor means that the public will protect the victim of a crime. When a defendant violates a law, he or she has committed a crime not just against one victim, but against all of us, against society, against the people. And I was the attorney representing the people. My job was to enforce the people's laws, protect the integrity of the system, and stand up for vulnerable victims, including those who do not stand up for themselves. Sometimes this was more challenging than it seems. I had domestic violence cases in which the victim would not want the case to move forward. She would recant her statement to police, say she had previously lied, and beg us to dump the case. Or she would not show up to court at all. But those were sometimes the most important cases to prosecute. We had pictures of a woman with a bloody lip or a black eye. We had a 911 call with her sobbing and hyperventilating into the phone, gasping, "He's going to kill me." We had the officer who got to the apartment to find a terrified woman, a crying baby, and broken dishes. And when the officer found the suspect a few blocks away, we had a web of lies about where he'd been. Because the prosecutor's role is not just to protect the victim, but also to protect the public, we are empowered to file cases without victim cooperation if we believe we can prove the case with the evidence we have. Victims do not always self-identify as victims because of the way they have been manipulated and because they have internalized so much trauma. I suspected that the women pleading guilty to prostitution might actually be victims, regardless of whether they identified as such or ever felt able to report crimes committed against them. When I wasn't in trial on a variety of domestic violence, vandalism, and DUI cases, I was discovering everything I could about that motel and attempting to build a case. I learned that the owner often worked the front desk, and he and his employees regularly gave out condoms to hotel guests. They rented rooms for short periods of time, less than a night. They had ongoing calls and complaints from neighbors and many visits from the Stockton Police Department. One of the women working around the motel eventually explained how it worked. She said the men she met who were interested in commercial sex would walk into the office, ask the owner for a room key, pay cash, and even be given a condom. The owner would tell them to have a good time. The owner was not just complicit in making a living off the commercial sex trade, but was actually promoting it. It kept him in business, and he did not care that a teenager might be getting raped in one of his dingy little rooms. Based on surveillance, cooperation from witnesses, and other evidence we were able to collect, I wanted to charge the owner with conspiracy and aiding and abetting prostitution. To my knowledge, no one had ever used that theory before to prosecute a motel owner. My supervisor was excited about the case from the beginning. His name was Chuck Schultz. He was bright and charismatic, and he brought incredible energy with him to work each day. If you ever had a case you weren't sure about, you could count on telling him the facts and him being absolutely outraged about what the defendant had done. "You're telling me he purposefully busted his neighbor's fence? Of course you should go to trial on that. What a horrific thing for a person to do." Chuck was predictably furious with the motel owner for aiding and abetting in commercial sex acts, and he thought we could use the case to send a strong message by shutting down the motel and holding the owner accountable. In 2004, laws criminalizing human trafficking were still in their infancy. Conceptually, the crime was akin to involuntary servitude or slavery, but the statutory framework was not applicable to what was happening on the streets. In California, sex trafficking was not yet defined as a crime in the penal code, but prostitution was a crime, one of the oldest on the books. And the concept of aiding and abetting, that anyone who knowingly helps facilitate a crime can be held accountable for that crime, is a long-enshrined legal principle. There was also conspiracy, agreeing with another person, either the sex worker or the sex buyer, to commit a crime and committing one or more overt acts toward that crime, such as supplying a motel room. And there was also pimping, knowingly receiving earnings from prostitution in whole or in part, and pandering, soliciting on behalf of or providing a place for commercial sex. All of these statutes were designed to stop the economic expansion of the sex trade. This motel fit directly within what the law was designed to prevent. We charged the motel owner and manager with conspiracy to commit prostitution and pimping. Our theory was that in several individual instances, the owner received funds and provided a room, knowing that it would be used for commercial sex acts. The owner knowingly and willfully contributed to those crimes and received financial benefit as a result. As a backup plan, I had researched nuisance abatement laws and city code violations that could have also taken the motel out of business. But I didn't want this to be categorized as a nuisance. It wasn't about the neighbors who were complaining. It was about the proliferation of the commercial sex trade and how young, vulnerable women of color were being exploited. It was a novel approach and caught the judge off guard, but it actually worked out. The motel owner was represented by a private attorney. We agreed to several terms. The defendant pled guilty and the motel was shut down. It was a good first little step, but I knew that there was much more that needed to be done. We needed a cosmic shift in how we treated young people ensnarled in the dangerous life of the commercial sex trade. We needed to build cases against those who were quietly selling people for sex acts. And we needed to create a support system for victims. The images of those girls from that motel in Stockton were etched into my brain and would drive me throughout my career. More than a decade later, their suffering became the inspiration for the biggest case I ever prosecuted. By the time I became a supervising deputy attorney general at the California Department of Justice, the seedy motel, I realized, had metamorphosized into a website, backpage.com. Backpage was more lucrative, more prolific, and more evasive than the motel had ever been. But my legal strategy was the same. Follow the money and disrupt the system. 2. Operation Wilted Flower. In the criminal justice system, prosecutors exercise vast discretion. We decide whether to charge a defendant, what crime or crimes to charge, and what deal to offer. Whether I offered to postpone a defendant's case for 6 months on condition that he or she sober up, show proof of steady employment, and turn in community service hours in exchange for dismissal of the charges, or take the case to trial and ask for the maximum jail sentence would greatly impact the defendant's life and have ripple effects on the defendant's family. Based on the circumstances, either could be the appropriate move, and it was up to me, the prosecutor, to decide. I got schooled by savvy defense attorneys and scolded by scrupulous judges. I made mistakes and tried to learn from them. I saw the suffering of both defendants and victims and learned that justice doesn't keep score. There is really no such thing as a win or a loss. Each day, you go in, you do your very best work, you seek justice, and you pray to God that you can leave a lasting impact and make your community a little safer. The cases I handled helped develop my judgment and decision-making and taught me the rules of the criminal justice system. I learned how to value a case, when to make concessions and pick battles, and the importance of every single word a prosecutor says. I learned the value of talking to the jury after trial. I learned the importance of respecting the court and opposing counsel even when you vehemently disagree. And I humbly learned the impact that a prosecutor can have on the lives of both victims and defendants. After gaining valuable experience as a local prosecutor, in 2005, I became a deputy attorney general in the Division of Criminal Law, serving on the trial team. I would be handling larger, more complex cases originating across the state. I was thrilled. especially when I learned that a legendary prosecutor was working in the corner office down the hall from me. I'd first heard of Dave Drewliner when I was interning at the California Department of Justice in San Diego one summer during law school. He was prosecuting a big murder trial at the courthouse across the street. All the interns from our office were clamoring to get into the courtroom to watch him at work. An Army veteran, Dave had been chief of the homicide unit at the Sacramento County District Attorney's Office before being recruited as the chief of the criminal division at the Attorney General's office. But he didn't like managing the office. He wanted to prosecute cases. After a few years, he stepped down as chief but stayed on as a senior prosecutor, poring over the state's most complex homicide cases. Soon after I joined the Attorney General's office, I worked up the courage to introduce myself. Dave was over 6 feet tall and well-built, with slightly graying, shaggy brown hair. He typically dressed in rumpled dress pants, orthopedic shoes, and button-down Hawaiian shirts in a variety of floral patterns and colors. Clad in my usual black suit and white shirt combo, I told Dave the kind of work I'd done in Stockton and the kind I wanted to do. I offered to volunteer to help on any of his cases. We clicked immediately. Dave was easy to talk to, and we had a lot in common. 49ers football, drinking Bud Light despite the growing trendiness of Sacramento's craft beer scene, basketball, and particularly the Sacramento Kings, surfing, and the will to prosecute the most depraved and dangerous criminals in California. Dave became my mentor and got approval for me to work with him on virtually everything. We drove around the state for various cases, like one in Bakersfield, where gangbangers had held up a barbershop, robbed and carjacked a district attorney investigator, and later killed a teenager during a home invasion. We prosecuted another in Susanville, where a mass murderer would have been released had it not been for our intervention. Another, which became Dave's favorite cold case, involved a San Francisco police sergeant who was gunned down in the prime of his life by a radical terrorist group in 1971. Dave was an extraordinary lawyer. He was brilliant, dogged, and thorough. He was respectful and open-minded, listening to everyone, cops, victims, witnesses, defense attorneys, and their clients. He never lost his cool, and if he felt stress, he didn't show it. "If you fall down, get up before anyone sees you." That was one of his mottos. He was also relentlessly positive. If a judge excluded crucial evidence we had submitted, Dave would find a way to argue that the ruling was somehow good for us. "This cuts both ways," he would say. Dave was also fun to be around. I never got bored in the long car rides because he would tell an endless string of entertaining war stories about his cases and funny stories about his daughter and grandkids. When Carrie proposed and we planned a wedding in Rosarito, Mexico, I knew Dave had to be there. He charmed my whole family and inquired about the relatives he met for years later. Dave valued family. He was excited for Carrie and me as we started ours, even giving us a rambunctious black Labrador named Lulu, who chewed her way through everything we owned, couches, Christmas tree ornaments, and high heels. With Carrie and me both having busy jobs as lawyers, Dave always reminded me, no matter what was happening on our cases, to find balance and make time for family. We would also talk through cases, constantly gaming out scenarios in court and putting together cross-examination traps for defense witnesses. I had to remind Dave that just because he said something that sounded good didn't mean I could say it or do it. He had this special Dave power. Once we were at breakfast together in Susanville, and he was slowly making his way through a bowl of oatmeal. I had finished my coffee because I don't eat breakfast and was eager to get to court. It was after 8, and the judge would be taking the bench at 8:30. We had not been in front of this judge before, and I was going to be arguing a pre-trial motion. The last thing I wanted was to be late. But Dave was taking his time and then ordered bacon just as the waitress was bringing the check.
"You like bacon. You'll have some, right? You gotta eat something," he insisted.
"But I don't want to be late to court. The judge will yell at me."
"No, he won't. He won't even take the bench until 9.
So I ate the bacon, and we got to court about 8:45. The judge was already on the bench and berated us for being late.
"Counsel, we started at 8:30. You are late."
Dave casually responded that he thought the hearing was at 9 and that we had been enjoying a leisurely breakfast up the street. I wanted to hide under the table. Dave went on to discuss his relaxing morning, throwing in that this his co-counsel, who doesn't usually eat breakfast, liked the bacon. And the judge somehow seemed calmed by it.
"It sounds like you all had a nice breakfast. I should eat breakfast out sometime. Anyway, recalling the case of People versus Bowen."
We later laughed about it in the car, but I was still a little mad at Dave. There was no way I could have gotten away with what he had pulled off, and no reason to be late. I was still a young woman trying to prove myself in what was still very much a man's world. There wasn't room for me to make mistakes like that. After several years prosecuting murder cases with Dave, I badly wanted to create a new team with undivided attention to human trafficking, a growing and largely unaddressed epidemic. While a new law passed in 2006 defining the growing scourge of human trafficking and providing for both civil and criminal remedies, law enforcement still lacked the training and resources to enforce it. This was different from the pimping laws, which criminalized receiving earnings from a prostitute. The trafficking statute included the element of force, fear, or coercion, and recognized the person being sexually exploited as a victim. The California statute was similar to the Federal Trafficking Victims Protection Act, TVPA, which had been codified a few years before. The law was inspired by a 1995 case in California. A Thai garment worker escaped from a sweatshop in El Monte, a commercial city in Los Angeles County, where she had been held as a slave. The ensuing investigation led to the bust of the garment factory and the freeing of 72 other survivors who had been lured to the United States through false promises and forced to work as slaves at a small compound enclosed in barbed wire. The evolving legal landscape gave us new tools to go after traffickers. I never forgot the women from the motel in Stockton, and it wasn't just sex trafficking of girls. There were male victims, transgender victims, and people being trafficked in a variety of different industries, forced to work with no pay and no freedom. There was an outspoken group of survivor leaders pushing for greater awareness and support from law enforcement. It was an insidious crime, hidden in plain sight and impacting the most vulnerable of victims. Yet our office, like most offices, had not dedicated resources to stopping it. In 2010, I had approached the chief of my division and proposed starting a new unit with Dave Drewliner that would focus on organized crime. In my mind, this meant human trafficking, but I pitched it more broadly. Instead, thanks to the mortgage meltdown, I was tasked with spearheading a strike force to combat mortgage fraud while Dave continued to work on murder cases. My chief said it was a leadership opportunity, which is what management always says when they're assigning you something terrible that you don't want to do. I have since used the line myself. For the next few years, I labored in the financial weeds, rooting out and prosecuting unscrupulous attorneys, lenders, and realtors.
It wasn't the work I was hoping to do, but it ultimately gave me a set of tools and a unique way to go after sex traffickers. Eventually, we expanded the mission of the Special Crimes Unit to include organized crime. I was one step closer to adding human trafficking into the mix. Kamala Harris was Attorney General of California, and with her background as the District Attorney of San Francisco, she already understood the problem well. In 2006, she supported the first bill to make human trafficking a felony. As Attorney General, she doubled down on her commitment to the fight, supporting legislation to provide restitution to victims of trafficking and to enhance the penalties for trafficking of minors. She spoke frequently and passionately about the grave damage trafficking does to victims and communities, and commissioned a report detailing its prevalence throughout California. I had no resources and no team, but I had a powerful ally at the top. I received another boost in 2012 when Special Agent Ray Diaz transferred into our unit. Ray had a reputation as one of the best agents in the Department of Justice, but he had his own way of doing things and sometimes clashed with management. We'd met a few years earlier when he was part of a gambling enforcement team and needed help getting a fraud case against a casino filed. He was frustrated that the locals initially rejected the case and pleased with me for ensuring that the case was charged. Now, Ray and I were reunited and were turning our attention to human trafficking. We were both envelope pushers, looking for new challenges and opportunities to be creative. I hoped that a major successful prosecution that garnered media attention would persuade Attorney General Harris and her staff that we could use the criminal justice system to pursue trafficking systematically, rather than piecemeal, through low-level prosecutions. The overwhelming focus of law enforcement was still street-level prostitution busts. I wanted to go after the pimps and traffickers, the people making money off the exploitation of vulnerable victims. But these types of cases would take months to develop and would require additional personnel, as opposed to the one-night stings currently being orchestrated by local law enforcement and targeting either sex workers or their customers. We zeroed in on a group of residential brothels and massage parlors that were either hiding in suburban neighborhoods or masquerading as legitimate businesses. In reality, they were selling young, vulnerable girls and women, often from overseas, for commercial sex acts. Many of these women were lured into Asian trafficking rings and brought to the United States with the promise of career training and advancement. It was similar to the tactics the traffickers used in the garment factory case in El Monte nearly 20 years earlier. The victims were often fleeing poverty, trying to make money to support loved ones back home. Sometimes they were escaping violence and persecution. Other times, they were simply seeking a better life. That's not what they found. When they arrived in this country, they were told they were now thousands of dollars in debt and had to work to pay off the cost of their travel. Rather than working as professional massage therapists at spas or hotels, they found themselves forced into sex slavery. Sometimes they were told they only needed to sell their bodies for a few months and then they'd be free to leave. It was a lie. In addition to their travel fees, they now had expenses charged to them for room and board and security. They didn't speak English. They had no friends or family, no support network whatsoever, and they were told they'd go to prison or be deported if they talked to the authorities. Often, they weren't even allowed to leave the brothels. They slept in the same beds on which they serviced their clients. They were kept drugged, usually on ketamine, the date rape drug, because an unhappy girl was bad for business. After a week or so, they were rotated to other massage parlors or brothels up and down the West Coast and, in some cases, all the way across the country. These women lived their entire lives inside a succession of dirty little rooms, having sex with strangers for money. Those strangers found the brothels and massage parlors through websites such as Backpage.com and Rub Maps, as well as word of mouth, ads in foreign language newspapers, and even business cards handed out at swap meets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.